It was an uprising that transformed the country and sent ripples of political dissent across the region. Hundreds of thousands of Egyptians demanded their president go, and he did. Hosni Mubarak was jailed and ousted. Then, Egypt's new president, Mohamed Morsi, was pushed out in a military coup led by Abdel Fattah el-Sisi with the backing of some in the country. But according to Egypt's new school history books, those events may as well have never happened. The Ministry of Education has decided to remove mention of both events from the national curriculum and instead widen it to include the First and Second World Wars and the history of colonialism. Plenty of other countries have done the same. In Japan, school history books don't mention war atrocities committed in China or Korea. Lebanese school books largely stop before the 1975 civil war because the country's different sects can't agree on a unifying narrative. In the U.S., the Education Board in Texas brought in new books that refer to the slave trade as the Atlantic Triangular Trade. Perhaps governments understand what George Orwell was getting at in his novel 1984, where the fictitious ruling party adopts the slogan, "Who controls the past controls the future. Who controls the present controls the past." Is Egypt within its right to revise its curriculum? Or is this the latest sign of a trend to silence political opposition? Egypt's president, Abdel Fattah el-Sisi, has been under fire for rounding up supporters of the Muslim Brotherhood and other opponents. A new bill to restrict the work of NGOs is also raising eyebrows. NGOs are now limited to social work only, and foreign organizations must pay up to $16,500 to work in Egypt. NGOs can no longer publish studies without government approval, and the price for non-compliance includes jail time. Egypt's defense is that NGOs and activists funded by foreign actors are a threat to national security.
This is what is expected in Egypt, but until we are completely banned from defending human rights, we will not give up our role and we will continue. Egypt is a police state, and it will not become democratic until there is democracy.
The Egyptian army is fighting several armed groups in Sinai. And supporters of President Sisi say tighter controls are justified. Critics, though, fear a return to Egypt's police state that was toppled by protests in 2011, an event that will no longer be discussed in classrooms. Sandra Gatman, The Newsmakers.
Well, to discuss this further, I'm joined now from Washington, D.C., by the president, former president of the Egyptian-American Alliance, Mukhtar Kamil. And from London, Omar Ismail. He's a political commentator focusing on Egyptian affairs. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us. Mukhtar Kamil, if I can begin with you, tell me why Egypt is rewriting history.
I don't think Egypt is the one who is rewriting history. What's rewriting history, in accordance with what I heard from you right now, is a regime that is governing Egypt. And they are rewriting history because they seem to be insisting to be viewed by the people, by the Egyptian people, as criminals. Rewriting history is a criminal act, and it can be almost treason, high treason, because rewriting history falsely means that you are producing generations with a myopic view of the future and a distorted view of reality.
Okay, Omar Ismail, this is nothing new. Right? I mean, it appears as if 1967, 1973, those wars, many Egyptians were led to believe in the school textbooks and so on that Egypt won and there were no problems. So given the broad historical lens, it's nothing new, right?
Well, I think really if you look back in history, Egypt is 7,000 years civilization. And the habits of rulers when they take over was always to remove any traces of previous rulers and try to spin what the events to their to their advantage or to big themselves up and make themselves look bigger than they really are. But I think I just have some reservation regarding the removal of the, or the alleged removal of the mention of the 25th of January and the 30th of, of June. I think if, for those of us who are actually closely in contact with Egypt and closely watch what is going on in Egypt, Egypt actually declared a public holiday on the Thursday, which is the 29th of June, which in celebration of what's happened
right.
In the 30th of June. Whether we call it a coup or a revolution, I'm not really going into this.
Okay,
at
so
all.
Let me so
I
let me give
what
you specific.
Happened was significant.
Sure. Okay. So, 2013 mass protests. Yes, the current Sisi government would like to look at it, you know, very positively and see it as a sort of revolution, right? Let me give you the specifics here. The Ministry of Education had decided to remove mention of 25th of January 2011, that uprising, that revolution, and you can call it whatever you want to, and the 30th of June 2013 from the high school curriculum. And this was reported in Al Ahram. So state-owned, is the voice of the state right now, no reason to doubt it. So high school students are not learning about these two events. What benefit can that be to the high school students?
Well, I'll have to say, and one has to be obviously true to history, and what it cannot be simply ignored. A significant event that happened on the 25th of January, whatever you want to call it, you can't really ignore it.
But that's what they're
because
doing.
Because it has changed. Yeah. What? Well, I think they're totally misguided because whether you are were supportive of the event or not, it has a significant. It affected the Egyptian government and the Egyptian psyche hugely, and it has a significant effect that the Egyptians are still feeling it. Since the 25th of January. And it actually led to a change of direction. And it ended up a 30
I guess it would be very difficult to deny it, even for the supporters of the regime, the staunch supporters of the regime. It's going to be very difficult for any supporter of the Sisi regime to really justify this thing. Because, I mean, it's... It's catastrophic. I mean, it's catastrophic. It is filthy. It can't be defended.
Right. And Mukhtar Kamel, in the age of social media and the fact that young people are going to get their information from somewhere, they're going to go on to Wikipedia and other places, right? So given that school's not teaching it
Absolutely.
To you, but you're going to get this information elsewhere, what kind of political maybe resentment is that going to harbor? Down the line, is it going to make things worse?
I would say, of course, I would say that the younger generations who are going to see history through the lenses of the social media and find that what they are told at school is different, they will be even more contemptuous of older generations who are teaching them that. They will be more contemptuous of the regime that is governing, assuming that the regime, this regime, is going to survive. That's one thing. A second point that I would like to make is that one of our problems really is the fact that we are kind, as Arabic-speaking people in general, we are kind of lenient about distorting history. And because of that, we in Egypt right now are in political tribes, are divided into political tribes. For instance, had the Islamists studied history without any falsification, they could have been in government right now, in ruling right now. The same thing applies to the Nasserists and the pan-Arabism. It applies to the military regime right now. The third and final point that I would like to comment on your guest from London, that saying that we Egyptians, through 7,000 years of history, have always been used to rulers coming and effacing the previous rulers' achievements and events is really kind of counterproductive. It is partially true.
Okay, so let's get Omar Ismail to respond to that. Omar Ismail, this is not business as usual for Egypt, and maybe it's giving the government a free pass by saying, we've always done this.
Yeah, and I think really just a response to the respected colleague from America. And I think if you look even as near as the last 60 to 70 years, and we've seen what Nasser did and completely tried, or I wouldn't say Nasser, but the regime then have tried, I wouldn't say Nasser in particular, but the regime have tried in a way to totally discredit the royal family that ruled Egypt from Muhammad Ali's days to Farouk's days. They have, the royal family, again, whether you agree with what they did or didn't do, has made impact on Egyptian life, huge impact
on Egyptian life.
And enriched the Egyptian life. Nasser came in and completely discredited that. So that after Nasser tried, and maybe to a certain degree, have succeeded in, you know, well, he was, you know, paying a lip service to the history of Nasser, and what Nasser has.
I was just, if you allow me, I was just commenting on the 7,000 years thing because. Right. That kind of...
I think the point I'm trying to make...
I agree with you. I completely... Just 1 second, please.
Yeah.
I completely agree with you concerning Nasser, Sadat, and so on and so forth. But the part that I do not agree with is accusing the Egyptian civilization, which continued... I mean, I don't mean you mean that necessarily, but it implies that. Accusing it of having always been like that, denying history, falsifying history, because that way we give justification for what is going on today and what Nasser has done, which you indicated.
It's not a justification, sir.
He isn't justifying it. He didn't mean that. No, certainly.
The Egyptians
you didn't mean it.
Are accepting.
Right.
The Egyptians are readily accepting what really the rulers always do and did in their name.
They didn't in 2011.
I totally agree with you.
Okay.
That's true.
Okay.
No, I understand. You two agree with each other. Maybe you disagree with the way he expressed it. Let me ask you, Mukhtar Kamil, about something related to this, related to the history books and related to the maps. Now, you might think there might not be any tangible benefits to removing the references to 2011 and 2013, and it might only be counterproductive. What about the two islands, Tiran and Sanafir? So, it's off the maps, right? And the sovereignty is out of the textbooks. There's a tangible benefit to that because there's Saudi money coming into the government. So can you maybe see the tactical benefit to the government that, okay, let's take out our references to the islands, and that means we get Saudi investment?
No, the islands business is nothing short of high treason. It is more than and deeper than just a few billion dollars we are getting from Saudi Arabia. The issue is basically the internationalization of the Straits of Tiran. And that internationalization is very, very serious for the Egyptian national security because simply Israel anytime in the future can build a railroad, for instance, from Eilat to the Mediterranean or to any place, can build oil pipelines to compete with the Suez Canal, or even can dig a canal, which I kind of think that it is not a possibility for the time being. But basically, taking such a strategic card from the country for nothing,
right,
other than few billion dollars, and the fact that Israel is cooperating with Saudi Arabia against Iran, that is high treason.
Okay.
As
so you
simple
consider
as
it high treason. Okay. I'm running out of time. So, Omar Ismail, let me ask you, should we be considering what's happening with the textbooks and how the youth are being educated in the same basket and the same atmosphere as media outlets being shut down, NGOs under a new law being regulated, and stitching all of these together and saying there's a particular atmosphere to the Sisi government that includes all of this and it doesn't look good? Is that fair?
Look, the Egyptian people are intelligent and they know exactly what their history is. And they would know in future, of future generation to come, what did really happen on the 25th of January 2011 has effectively changed the country's direction. It might be that the country direction at the moment is aimless and it is seemingly unsuccessful, but nonetheless, a change has taken place. And these facts will remain facts whether the Ministry of Education in Egypt like it or not.
Okay. Unfortunately, we're out of time. It's been a pleasure talking to both you gentlemen. Thanks so much, Mukhtar Kamil and Omar Ismail.
Thank you.
Hope to have you on the program again.